From every 2D to 3D Mario, this is how players broke every single mainline Mario game. On September 13th, 1985, Super Mario Bros. Would be released for the Nintendo Entertainment System, and this game alone would not only skyrocket itself to legendary status, but it would set the foundation for any and all future Mario games. Over the last four decades, players have not only cracked the code to the older Mario games, but they have also managed to shred the new games to pieces at unforeseen rates. So without further ado, this is how players broke every 2D Mario. Now with most of these 2D Mario games, you'll notice that simply just running right with minimal slowdowns will get you quite a long ways, and Super Mario Bros. Is absolutely no exception. You'll also notice that each game has its own respective categories on the leaderboards, all of which are broken in their own ways. But for the purposes of this video, I will be sticking to any percent, which entails that you beat the game as fast as possible. When it comes to any percent, players will take advantage of the warps scattered throughout the game, but they'll also take advantage of much more. When it comes to Super Mario Bros., the way in which you lose and/or gain time can be attributed to the famous frame rule system. Every 0.35 seconds that passes, frame rule does as well. However, you could only pass through the game in frame rules, meaning that if you were to lose or gain time, it would be in increments of 0.35 seconds. This knowledge is important for not only the speedrun, but for any and all future discoveries that would be made. In the early 2000s, the world record stood at around 5.5 minutes, but since then, the record alongside the tasks or tool-assisted speedrun sits at 4 minutes and 54 seconds, with the task being merely frames away from the 4:53 barrier. The world record itself stands at a 4:54.798 by the iconic Nifsky. But how did the record get to where it is today? Well, at the beginning of the game's life, there were a few tricks that would eventually be implemented into runs as a means of saving time, such as the wall jump in 8-4, a wrong warp in 8-4, and another wrong warp in 4-2 that would allow for you to skip having to use the vine. Now this wrong warp was pretty easy in 8-4. All you had to do was walk forward to scroll the screen, and if you scroll the screen forward enough, then the game would just take you to this underwater section via the pipe as opposed to the pipe further along in the stage. The same concept applied in 4-2, but the methods in which you used to scroll the screen were a bit more complicated. Players would have to figure out how they could scroll the screen without slowing down. This is where Andrew G enters the equation. By bumping Mario against the wall like this, you're able to scroll the screen. If you bump Mario against the wall 3 times, then you're able to scroll the screen by enough pixels to allow you to successfully pull off the wrong warp every time. However, if you got 2 really good bumps, then you would just barely be able to get the wrong warp, and you would also save even more time over the 3-bump strategy. With all of those strategies, Andrew G was able to beat Super Mario Bros. In under 5 minutes and even get a 4:58. Despite the absurdity of this time, Andrew and others knew that there was potential for the run to be brought down lower than any of them could even imagine. It was at around this time in which the bullet bill glitch in 8-2 was implemented into runs. As the name implies, runners use this bullet bill to clip into the bottom of the flagpole, and this glitch in particular would allow for 2 frame rolls to be saved. With the discovery of the bullet bill glitch, another glitch would be discovered regarding the flagpole, but this time, it would be a glitch that could be performed and used to save time on every single level with a flagpole. This would unsurprisingly be the flagpole glitch, in which you are able to clip near the bottom of the flagpole, allowing for frame rolls to be saved. Now, you remember when I said that you have to scroll the screen in 4-2 to successfully pull off this wrong warp? Well, a new way of scrolling the screen would be found, and it involved this precise clip into the wall, which if done right, is able to scroll you exactly 20 pixels forward, which is just enough to pull off the wrong warp. Outside of that, the ampersand run really just came down to optimal movement. Fast excels would be added throughout the run as a means of just barely saving some frame rules, which if you don't know what a fast excel is, it's basically just doing a jump in the opposite direction and then quickly turning around. It's one thing to do the excel, but it's definitely another to do it fast enough to save the frame roll you need, which is why it took so long for some fast excels to be added into runs, such as this one in 8-4. While the current world record is extremely optimized, there's still time to be saved, and it'll only be a matter of time before the record is beaten. One year after the massive success and release of Super Mario Bros., Nintendo would release Super Mario Bros. And the Lost Levels, which had the same engine and format as its predecessor, but it featured much more difficult levels. While I view this game as painful and excruciating, speedrunners saw this game as a challenge and quickly began to break it apart, as they did with the original game. This game's history begins in 2008, with Andrew G once again dominating the speedrunning side of things. The first run that I could find clocked in at an 8:34, and while there were slip-ups here and there, there were no major mistakes made, and Andrew even went for a glitch in 5-2. Similar to the wrong warp in 4-2 of Super Mario Bros., Andrew would scroll the screen here, in which he then jumped in between where the pipe and screen was, before ultimately clipping into and entering the pipe, allowing for him to make it to the World 8 warp pipe. As time progressed, mistakes within these any percent runs would lessen and problems to certain levels would be solved. For example, in the final level of the run, there are multiple Bowsers, all of which have their own hammer patterns. Players initially didn't know how exactly they could control the hammer patterns, as a lot of the time, runs would die as a result of it. But with improved knowledge regarding enemy patterns, players found out that you could control what pattern you get, as it's reliant on when you enter the level. This meant no more slowing down. Optimizations like these and more would allow for the run to be brought down all the way to a low 8-minute time, and before people knew it, the grind for sub 8 would start to commence. With the help of some wall jumps, a faster wrong warp setup in 5-2, this 8-2 Koopa jump, and additional frame rules throughout some of the other levels, Darbian was able to squeeze out a sub 8-minute time. After the sub 8, a lot of strategies were discovered slash implemented into runs. There was this clip in 1-2, multiple flagpole glitches, another clip in 4-4, an even faster warp in 5-2, and additional frame rule saves as a result of tighter movement. The record now stands at a 751.956 by Nifsky, but it's theorized that the record can be brought down all the way to a 749 and beyond. With the release of Super Mario Bros. 2, the same legends who initially picked up the original Super Mario Bros. Would also migrate to this game. One of the first recorded world records would be a time set by Scott Kessler in 2005. This is how he did it. As he enters 1-1, you'll see that he's using Luigi. This is because Luigi has the highest jump out of the four characters featured in Mario Bros. 2, meaning that Scott would be able to make jumps you usually wouldn't be able to make. Later on in the run, he'll use Toad for some stages, as his speed comes in handy, but as far as Peach and Mario go, well, they simply just aren't featured in the run, because Peach's floatability can't compare to Luigi's jump, and Mario is just Mario. In the first two levels, Scott rolled with Luigi and used him to skip parts of the stage, whether it be this jump in 1-1 or this sequence of jumps that allows you to skip the carpet in 1-2. In 1-3, he switched to Toad and picked up one of the first enemies he saw. For some reason, when a Toad has an object or enemy in his hands, he actually runs faster, a mechanic that only Toad has. Therefore, Scott took advantage of this mechanic throughout some other levels, and he also took advantage of the warps this game has to offer. After some Birdo fights, skips, and risky maneuvers, Scott finished his run with a time of 9:42. Over the following years, Scott's run would not only be improved upon the liking of players such as Chris Knight and Andrew G, but there would be a few discoveries that pushed the game to below 9 minutes. There were new ways of defeating Birdo, a trick in 6-3 that involved ricocheting a Shy Guy off of this wall so that you could hop on it and effectively traverse your way towards this door, as opposed to slowly sinking below the wall, this Shy Guy clip in 1-1, and even this double jump that you're able to perform with Toad. With all of these skips, Andrew G would return to Super Mario Bros. 2, and he would execute the first ever sub 9-minute run, which was then beaten by CAC without any of the glitches I just mentioned. Now you may be wondering how CAC even pulled this off, or why CAC decided against using glitches. Well, back in the day, Speed Demos Archive was one of the main driving sites for speedrunning. However, all runs of Speed Demos Archive were glitchless, or at the very least had very strict rules in place. CAC was simply just complying to the rules at the time, hence why he did not perform any glitches. But when it came to beating Andrew G, who used all of the glitches I mentioned, CAC would find a lot of the time saved in the later half of the run. In Super Mario Bros. 2, there are cycles for both the vegetables that shoot out of these pipes during the warp boss fight, alongside the eggs Birdo shoots out. These cycles happen every 256 frames, which equates to about 4 seconds. As a result of less hesitation, CAC was able to save cycles on Andrew in the later half of the run, and he only lost about 5 seconds to Andrew in the beginning of the run, as in some cases, cases, Andrew pulling off a glitch wasn't enough to make it to the faster cycle. With this in mind, what would happen if CAC implemented glitches into his run? CAC had gotten what was almost a perfect run at the time. Despite others trying the game for themselves, CAC remained on top for years. But if I've learned anything about life, and especially speedrunning, it's the fact that nothing lasts forever. From here on out, Super Mario Bros. 2 would be brought down second by second, and strategies from tool-assisted speedruns would start to make their way into runs. The most notable of these strategies was this new yet much harder method of the warp in 1-1. Not only did this save an additional cycle, but the faster Birdo kill saved some additional time. With all of these optimizations and more, the record now stands at an 811.590 by CoolKid, a record that has dominated the leaderboard since November 16th of 2021. When 1988 rolled around, Super Mario Bros. 3 would release, and it would not only transform gaming as a whole, but it would transform speedrunning as well. Instead of there being warp pipes, there were instead warp whistles. While these were secretly hidden throughout the game, players only needed this one in 1-3 and this one in 1-Fortress, as using the first warp whistle would lead you to this island, and then using another warp whistle while on the island would lead you directly to World 8. Throughout the run, players will always be trying to optimize their P speed. The higher this bar is, the more P speed you have. If the bar is full, then you've reached your maximum running speed. Alongside P speed, the run also contains RNG or luck. Luck is most prominent in World 8, as there is this section with the hands here. If you get caught by one of these hands, then you have to make your way through a mini level, which loses about 15 seconds. You can get up to 3 hands if you're really unlucky, but on the off side, there's about a 12% chance you get no hands at all. Outside of those two things, the run contained difficult platforming sections, few auto-scroller levels, and even the Fire Flower, which was used to optimize certain sections and ultimately used to get a quick kill on Bowser. While the run had humble beginnings, it now stands at a 1041.083 by Kudo1K. However, a player by the name of Rat926 would discover a glitch that would change any percent forever. I'll link a more detailed explanation to how this wrong warp works in the description of the video, but essentially you are doing all of these various tasks with pixel perfection so that you can break the game's code and make it all the way to the end. You'd still get the two warp whistles you needed in World 1, but this time you'd go to World 7, and from there, all players had to do was pull off the wrong warp in 7-1. So while the any percent wrong warp list record stands at a 1041, any percent with the wrong warp would allow for the game to be beaten in exactly 3 minutes. Unlike the previous Mario games, Super Mario Land would be the first to be released on a Nintendo Game Boy, which was a handheld device as opposed to a home console. Because of this, footage of the game's early speedruns is very far and few between. Despite this, the game would eventually migrate its way to future consoles, which made capturing footage of it much more accessible. And in 2006, a player by the name of Martin Hauer would complete a run in 14 and a half minutes. This run was impressive for its time, as Martin didn't make any major mistakes and didn't even slow down all too much until the later sections of the run. However, it didn't feature any insane glitches or groundbreaking strategies. He simply just made his way through the 12 levels and went about his day. But in 2012, a player by the name of NES Kamikaze posted a run that clocked in at 12 minutes and 58 seconds. Kamikaze not only made less mistakes, but he also had much less hesitation when going through parts of the stage. Furthermore, Kamikaze would damage boost his way through certain sections and overall just take more advantage of the power-ups. As time progressed, cleaner execution of the any percent route would lead the time down second by second, but eventually, a rather interesting trick would be discovered. In 2-3, you go through episode is essentially an airplane sequence, which involves shooting at walls and dodging enemies. Players figured out that by getting stuck on the wall here, you're able to wrap your way to the other side of the screen, and if done successfully, you'll be wrapped to the end of the level, allowing you to save time in what would usually just be an auto-scroller level. There's one important factor that I haven't mentioned yet though. At the end of each world, there is a bonus game that you play, and the item you get within the bonus game is completely luck-oriented. The optimal item for the bonus game is to get a fire flower, but in some situations, you have to climb up or down a ladder, which loses time. On top of that, there's a chance that you don't get the fire flower, and you have a ladder which loses even more time. Therefore, the ideal situation is to get a fire flower that is on the same row as Mario. The time loss from bad luck wasn't too huge, but it was definitely enough to stop any and all any percent runs in their tracks. If the stars were able to align, then a low 12-2x time would be possible, which is exactly what happened, as in May of 2023, a player by the name of Shaft was able to get a time of 1221.82, which is where the record stands today. Soon after the Game Boy made its debut, the Super Nintendo Entertainment System would make its way onto shelves with a brand new Mario game. This game would of course be Super Mario World, and the any percent speedrun would only feature 11 levels, as you're able to use these keys to get to Star Road, and after progressing a bit through Star Road, you'd be able to go straight to Bowser's Castle and beat the game. Unsurprisingly, Scott Kessler would once again hold one of the first world records, clocking in at a time of 11:24. Not only did he go through each of the 11 exits with very nice movement, but he was able to hold on to the cape power-up and utilize it in ways that saved lots of time. As the years passed, players such as Lucid File, Yapusan, Yosuba, Menbu93, and Andrew G would all take turns with the world record. By 2011, the record had been brought all the way down to a 1044 thanks to cleaner movement alongside some newer optimizations, whether it be preserving cape speed through these doors or even using the cape to defeat Bowser faster. But from here on out, this game would get broken, and it would get broken fast. The first of many tricks would be coined as the orb glitch. In Super Mario World, there is this ghost ship level, and upon completing the level, you collect this green orb, which is the game's signal to give you a level completion. Now, this orb is intended to only appear in this stage, in this stage only, but you are actually able to perform a glitch that allows for you to put this orb in your item slot in one of the first levels of the game. Once you make it to this part of the stage, you are able to hit this enemy with a fireball, which will then turn it into a coin. If you then spin jump off of Yoshi, Yoshi will attempt to eat the coin. However, if you collect the coin right as Yoshi is about to eat it, then Yoshi will instead eat whatever the next thing is, which in this case is a charging chuck that is barely just off screen. The caveat here is that Yoshi is not supposed to eat this enemy, so the game's code gets confused and just casually puts a green orb in your item slot. Therefore, players were able to use this orb to skip one level, and they determined that the first castle of the game would be the most optimal level to skip, as it would save upwards of 15 seconds. While this glitch would bring the record all the way down to a sub 10:30 time, another glitch would be discovered that surprisingly saved even more time. In Yoshi's Island 2, you're able to hop on Yoshi and spit out a green shell. You can then grab another green shell and place it here so that you can then turn it into a coin. If you then collect the coin before Yoshi can, Yoshi will once again eat the next off-screen item, which in this case is another chuck. But instead of there being a green orb in your item slot, there will instead be a Lakitu cloud, which ends up looking like this. This Lakitu cloud can then be used to save a buttload of time in the boss fight against Bowser, as you're able to just hover directly next to him. This glitch would bring any percent all the way down to a sub 10 minute time, and the current world record with this route stands at a time of 940.916 by Oil and Water. While this glitch in Yoshi Island 2 is very impressive, there would be another glitch found that saved a bit more time. Yes, your eyes do not deceive you. We once again had another credits warp on our hands, and while multiple people have been able to pull this off, Furious holds the world record with a time of 41.02. If you want an in-depth understanding of how the trick works, I'll once again leave a link in the description, but as of today, this record has stood for 3 years, and I don't see it getting beaten anytime soon. With the conception of Super Mario Land on the Game Boy, Super Mario Land 2 and the 6 Golden Coins would hit the shelves in 1992, and there was much more content to unpack this time around. The speedrun would contain just about double the amount of levels as the original, and when it came to routing the speedrun, there was a lot more untapped potential because while the game required that you make your way through its 6 zones, the order in which you complete these zones is up to you. In 2005, a player by the name of Aqua Tiger would complete a full any percent run with a time of 32 minutes and 6 seconds. This run was very impressive, as Tiger not only managed to get a deathless run, but a rather fast one at that. While there weren't any crazy tricks discovered at the time, Tiger made rather effective use of both the Fire Flower alongside the Bunny power-up. It's also important to note that Super Mario Land 2 does not have a bonus game system like its predecessor. As we've seen with all the past Mario records, this Mario record would be optimized quite a bit despite the run still being glitchless. By the time 2012 rolled around, a player by the name of Mug had brought the record all the way down to 27 minutes. While most of the time saved from the previous run came from cleaner movement, a lot of it also came from smarter power-up use alongside better routing. In most 2D Mario games, losing a power-up usually serves as quite the negative. However, power-ups are a lot more frequent in this game, so sometimes it's actually beneficial to lose your power-up if it means you could damage boost your way through a section or get another power-up. Furthermore, ways of defeating bosses faster were discovered, whether it be a faster Wario kill or a quicker space boss. In March of 2013, Controller Head would be the first to get a 26-minute time, and 10 years later, the record now stands at a 26:14.250 by Ayaka Perfect Dream. But as we've seen with past Mario games, players always find ways to break games to their absolute limits, and Super Mario Land 2 is no exception. On the oldest version of the game, you are able to do something called the pipe glitch. If you exit a level while Mario is going down a pipe, the game will store that into its memory. Therefore, if you re-enter the level you just exited, the game will still think that you are going down the pipe, and in turn will shoot you out of bounds. However, this out of bounds area isn't just a random out of bounds area, it's actually a part of the game's source code. Basically, this mess of tiles and whatnot is the game's way of representing its source code, and in this particular section, you are going through the game's ROM. You are then able to do a series of very difficult inputs to make your way to the game's RAM, and it is from there in which you are able to break a block or change a byte of RAM. In changing this byte of RAM, you are warped directly to the credits of the game. If you want a more in-depth explanation, then I've linked a video down below, but when it comes to a world record, a player by the name Elecman holds the title with a time of 2 minutes and 34 seconds. After 1992, there would be a gap in 2D Mario titles as Nintendo focused more of their attention to the 3D Mario games, but come 2006, New Super Mario Bros. Would be the first of many New Super Mario Bros. Titles, and with these games, of course, came speedruns. In August of 2006, Chrono Rocks would post a video of a world record, and this record was very breathtaking to say the least. The run would of course start off in 1-1, like most runs do, but following 1-2, he would get this blue shell and use it throughout World 1 until he eventually made his way to the secret exit in 1-Tower, allowing for him to go straight to World 5. From World 5, he's able to take another secret exit in 5-2 that takes him to the Ghost House in World 5, and then the secret exit in the Ghost House would take him all the way to World 8. From there, Chrono took advantage of a plethora of useful strategies, whether it be using the Blue Shell and Fire Flower to make stages quicker, or even performing this quick kill on Bowser Jr. While the run did feature some small mistakes and slowdowns, Chrono was able to finish out the run in 24 minutes and 31 seconds. This record would go on the stand for not just one day, one month, or even one year. This record would stand for 9 years straight. Let me explain. For starters, the beginning of the any percent run is absolutely brutal. If you've ever played this game, you'll know that these item blocks will appear in certain stages. The first of these item blocks would of course be in World 1, and it is essentially a coin toss as to whether it'll go to 1-2 or whether or not it'll go to 1-T, given its 50-50 odds. If the item block happens to go to 1-T, then your run is automatically dead, as you'll need the blue shell for not only a good time, but for the secret exit in 1-T. There are of course other ways of getting a blue shell, but this is by far the fastest way. But it gets even worse, as getting the item block doesn't even guarantee you'll get the blue shell, as there is a chance of getting a 1-up and a chance of getting a fire flower. This means that almost 80% of runs will not make it out of 1-2. Furthermore, there is luck involved later on in the run, as in 8-8, these meteors would randomly drop drop out of the sky. So not only was Chrono's run ahead of its time, but it was also just hard to capture footage because like the Game Boy, the Nintendo DS was a handheld device. Eventually, that ninth year would come in which the record would finally fall. The person to do it would be a man by the name of E. Waller, who would get a time of 24:28. Now, of course, players would figure out ways around both the shell luck issue and technology would advance, which motivated more players to pick up the game. Since E. Waller's run in 2015, the record has been brought all the way down to a 22:11 by Josh TGR. For starters, Josh uses the blue shell more throughout the run. Optimal movement with the blue shell allows you to save seconds upon seconds in every stage, and that adds up very quickly throughout an entire run. One of the most notable time saves with the blue shell would be an 8-2. If timed correctly, you're able to pull off this double jump with the shell. The only problem is the fact that the trick is frame perfect. While players have gotten better at it over the years, it still serves as a pivotal point in the run, as you'll either get it first try and save the 7 seconds, or you'll just simply start over again. Nonetheless, Josh still uses the Fire Flower throughout a lot of World 8, as it proves to be faster than the blue shell, especially in sections such as this one in 8-6, because you're able to time fireball jumps to bypass having to slowly walk across these rock platforms. While this run can be brought down to a 22:00, this record still stands, and it stands strong. While most games took quite some time to gather a speedrunning scene, New Super Mario Bros. Wii would be the first Mario game to gather a prominent scene following its launch. Riker Z would be the first to set a series of recorded world records, and come 2012, he had set a time of 25:27. While the run itself was pretty straightforward, Riker Z's time proved to be untouchable for years. The run started off with him getting the propeller suit, power-up that would be used throughout the rest of the game as a means of saving time. Whether it be the towers, this level with the route, in World 5, or even the end of the game, it was very necessary that Riker Z held on to the propeller suit he got from 1-1, as he needed it to save time throughout the rest of the game. Outside of that, there were small optimizations thrown into the mix, even if it was something as simple as just sliding down slopes. Despite Riker Z's run standing for years, lots of change would strike the Any% run. First of these changes would actually be a change regarding how runs were timed. Players would come to the realization that load times were different for everyone, which meant that some players would have an unfair advantage over others. Therefore, all runs would begin to be timed without loads, which if you take Riker Z's run, his 25-minute time would now be the equivalent of a 23-minute time. Now, I mentioned how the propeller suit was a very vital part of the run, but at the time of Riker Z's run, he didn't perform anything too crazy with it. But as time progressed, the propeller suit would get taken advantage of in unforeseen ways, whether it be in 5-Dash Tower, which you're able to make this platform cycle that was originally thought to be tasks only, or an 8-dash airship in which you are able to do these tight maneuvers to aid in defeating Bowser Jr. quicker. With the help of these tricks and more, the Any% run would be brought all the way down to a low 22-minute time without loads, but as of recently, there's one trick discovered that changed everything. Normally, when you're making your way through the final castle, you have to wait for Bowser to shoot fireballs through the wall, as him shooting those fireballs is your only means of progression. Speedrunners were tired of being bottoms, so they decided to go on top, and while the results were a big time save, a time save big enough to push the category to a 21-minute time. As of today, the record stands at a 21:56.4 by Sharp Runs, and players are still actively pushing this category despite how optimized it is. Among the New Super Mario Bros. Titles, players often forget about New Super Mario Bros. 2, which was released on the 3DS in 2012. While this game doesn't feature a blue shell or a propeller suit, its speedrun has gotten to crazy levels of optimization in ways that might be seen as unexpected. A player by the name of Greenalink would be among the first to optimize the game. He would grind the Any% run down second by second, and by the time 2015 rolled around, he would get his time all the way down to a 26:39. When it comes to the route, Greenalink of course starts off in World 1, but from there he takes the Warp Cannon to World Mushroom, and from there he is able to go to World Flower, which eventually leads him to Bowser's Castle. Throughout this run, Greenalink pays a lot of attention to details that are very underlooked. An example of this would be him being cautious when it comes to coin collection, so that way he can skip coin tally update delays at the end of levels. Furthermore, he uses multiple power-ups throughout the run, whether it be the Tanuki suit, in which he is able to do a trick called dash flying, in which you mash both dash and jump at the same time, so that you can stay at max speed while flying, or other power-ups such as the Fire Flower, Golden Fire Flower, or even the Star as a means of blazing through stages quicker. After Greenlink finished his run, he noted that even if he cleaned up the small time loss he had in Bowser's Castle, his record would still stand as a 26.39, and that there was little room for this time to be brought down. But of course, as time progressed, the 80% run would be brought down in all types of small ways, whether it be something as big as optimizing Tanuki movement, or something as small as aiming for 2000 on the flagpole as a way of saving mere frames. Because of those optimizations and much more, the world record now stands at a 26.04.533 by the legendary Glitchman24. Now, we've seen old school and new school Mario throughout this video, and the common theme between both of them is that they've been shredded to pieces no matter what. From Super Mario Bros. All the way to New Super Mario Bros. 2, the 2D Mario speedrunning scene has come quite a long way, but there's one game that I haven't mentioned yet. This game would be none other than Super Mario Bros. Wonder. Oh, I'm sorry about that. Wrong video. What I meant to say is that this game would be none other than New Super Mario Bros. U. Similar to New Super Mario Bros. Wii, this game would get optimized quick, with players figuring out the most optimal path for the 80% route. This path being that you would take the secret exit in 1-2, which would eventually lead you to World 5, in which you would then take the secret exit out of 5-Dash Ghost House, which would lead you to World 7, and from there you'd be able to make it all the way to Bowser's Castle, which lied in World 8. The first completed 80% run to be submitted on speedrun.com would be a time of 44 minutes and 55 seconds by ColdBlood222, but as time went on, this record would be very quickly optimized to a 37 minute time, with Pokey getting the first 37 just 5 months after the game came out, and like other world records, this record would go absolutely viral on YouTube, garnering an astounding 36 million views. It made sense as to why records such as these went viral. I mean, this record by Pokey was a record set while the game was still very fresh, and it was a record that featured very minor mistakes. He not only kept his acorn suit throughout the run, but he used it to his advantage throughout every single level, allowing for him to beat out the rest. 37 minutes could have very well been the last minute barrier New Super Mario Bros. U ever saw, but spoiler alert, things would change. Okay, that's cool and all, but what about the 3D Mario games?
From the get-go, Super Mario 64 was not safe from being picked apart by players. One of the most famous tricks in all of gaming history would be quickly discovered after the game's release, this trick being the BLJ, which is also known as the backwards long jump. Using the BLJ, you are able to bypass the 70 star requirement to get into the final Bowser stage, as backwards long jumping against these stairs was possible as the developers of the game did not account for a speed cap when it came to backwards momentum. Given this discovery, players would start to question one thing. This one thing would be, how little stars could you complete Super Mario 64 with? While most people know that you can beat the game with no stars at all, most people don't know the journey in which it took to get to that point we are at today. With the discovery of the BLJ, you are able to beat the game with less than 70 stars, and with these two BLJs, you are able to beat the game with only 31 stars, given that this is the bare minimum requirement for accessing the upstairs portion of Peach's Castle. Time would pass, and for a while, the minimum amount of stars required to beat the game would stay at 31. However, this would all change thanks to one special rabbit. Using MIPS, in which you unlock MIPS in the basement after you collect 15 stars, you are able to clip through this door here, which allows you to then clip through the fire seed door that you would usually only be able to open with 30 stars. This means that you can make your way upstairs and all the way to the end of the game with just 16 stars. To this day, the 16 star run is one of the most played speedruns in all of speedrunning history, and Green Suiji holds the world record at 14 minutes and 35 seconds, a world record that is absolutely ahead of its time. But it doesn't end here though, as the crazy BLJ would would be discovered that would allow for you to beat the game with one star. This is SBLJ. If you BLJ against a small flight of stairs, you are able to launch yourself all the way in a dire dire docks. However, if you get an optimal launch, then you are able to skip dire dire docks entirely, allowing for you to beat the entire game with 0 stars. Green Suiji once again holds the world records for both of these categories, and the tool assisted speedruns behind these runs are absolutely mind boggling. But let's not get it twisted, players have also found ways to break both the 70 star run and the 120 star run, which is the equivalent of 100% in this game. Both of these runs not only feature insane movement with little to no room for error, but they also exploit each of the levels in their own ways, whether it be this glitch on Tall Tall Mountain or this strategy on Hazy Mazy Cave. To this day, Super Mario 64 is still being shredded to pieces, and I can only imagine where it'll be in a decade from now. 6 years later, Super Mario Sunshine would be released on the GameCube, and similar to its predecessor, this game would quickly be broken to pieces. With the inclusion of Flood, players would find plenty of ways to use Flood to their advantage, whether it be for movement purposes or whether it be for out of bounds clips such as this one that is used to skip Gelato Beach. Outside of this, there are plenty of other glitches that are used to optimize not only the Any% category, but the other categories as well. Using the rocket nozzle, you are able to perform a glitch called Rocket Storage,
which not only allows for you to reach unimaginable heights,
but it allows for you to skip this climbing section in Corona Mountain. In Pinna Park, you are able to do something called the Fruit Storage Glitch,
which allows for you to skip the merry-go-round
that you use to access this part of the stage. In Piana Village, you are able to do this out-of-bounds clip, which allows for you to collect the fifth shine. But even with all of these glitches and cool movement strategies, there's one factor that keeps players from getting to the level of optimization we see in other Mario games. This factor would be luck. For example, if we look at the Any% run, there will be multiple instances of luck, or RNG, that can very easily plague the entire thing. In Piana 5, there's this Piana that you need to rely on to launch you over to the shine. However, there are some cases in which he will not immediately launch you, meaning that you'll have to wait an additional 20 seconds, which doesn't sound like too much, but in the scope of an Any% run, this time loss can just flat out kill the run, especially if your early game wasn't the strongest. In Serena 5, you face off against this Boo, and you once again have to rely on RNG as you need the right slot combination to progress through the fight. In Serena 1, you have to not only clean up the beach, but you have to defeat these manta rays that will propel themselves in completely random directions. All of this and more can very easily stop your run right in its tracks, yet players such as JJSRL have been able to persevere through it all and beat the game in 1 hour and 13 minutes. Now, you wouldn't think that the Galaxy games would be as broken as Sunshine 64, given their speedrunning scenes aren't as prominent, but this notion couldn't be any further from the truth. Starting with Super Mario Galaxy 1, Jay holds the Any% world record with a time of 2:13:57, but there's also a 120 and 2:42 star category that are just as broken. People will usually go with Luigi over Mario as he has a higher jump, which creates for an easier time at pulling off certain tricks, such as this one in Honey Hive Galaxy, in which you are able to scale this tree and then make your way over to the other tree with Captain Toad on it as a result of clever movement. But just because tricks like this one are easier with Luigi doesn't mean that they are impossible with Mario. But the skips and tricks get even crazier as you're able to do this on Battle Rock Galaxy. That's right, you are able to do all of that to skip the auto-scroller section in Battle Rock. But things get even crazier in Galaxy 2, as there are not only more power-ups and stages added into the equation, but there's a certain green dinosaur that would take the game by storm. Using Yoshi, you are able to perform what is called an infinite flutter. As the name implies, you are able to infinitely flutter, meaning that you can not only go as high as you want, but you're able to go as far as you want, creating skips such as this one on Yoshi's Star Galaxy, or this one on Starshine Beach. Outside of infinite fluttering, there are plenty of gravity exploits in not only the first game, but this one as well. In Flip Swap Galaxy, you are able to time a long jump in which you are able to get a ridiculous amount of height and distance. In Bowser's Gravity Gauntlet, you are able to do this absurd strategy to skip a part of the stage alongside this skip that completely skips you having to open up this door. And in The Perfect Run, you are able to perfect your run with groundbreaking strategies. Now, I know that Super Mario 3D Land and World aren't the same type of 3D that the other games are, but I mean, they have 3D in the name, they clearly aren't two-dimensional, and they are both way more broken than you would expect. Starting with Super Mario 3D Land, things get freaky. I mean, just look at the speedrun of 1-1 by Luigi Master. You see that he uses both the Tanuki suit and the star power-up to do what is called vectoring, which entails that you jumping side to side will allow for you to gain lots of speed. However, when it comes to full-on speedruns of this game, a lot of it simply just comes down to optimal movement, as seen in Zelda Cube's Any% World Record of 53.31, or even these other three categories have all been optimized in their own individual ways. But when November 21st of 2013 came around, Super Mario 3D World would release for the Wii U, and I would argue that it is the most broken game of them all. Upon collecting the cat power-up in Super Mario 3D World, you are of course able to climb walls and do these cat dives, but if you do this cat dive, followed up with either another jump or a scratch, you are able to once again do another cat dive and preserve the increased momentum you are able to get from the initial cat dive. Now if you do this but crouch upon landing from the cat dive, then you are able to increase the amount of momentum you can get, allowing for you to cover more distance and of course gain more speed. Now if you do this crouch on a sloped surface, you are once again able to build up even more momentum, allowing for a bigger increase in distance and speed. Now if you do all of that while vectoring and using the proper character for the proper stage, then you are able to achieve what I like to call God speed. I mentioned the proper character for the proper stage, as certain characters are more optimal for certain stages given their distinct abilities. On 3 Train, you are able to use Peach's float ability to jump from train to train, allowing for you to scroll through the stage faster. In 2-5, Toad's short hops and speed are useful as there isn't any extensive platforming featured within the level, and for most of the Any% run, Luigi is present as he not only jumps higher than every character, but he's the most slippery, meaning that you can get bigger crouch boosts with him. Outside of the cat suit, you are able to bypass auto-scroller levels, do some funky out-of-bounds glitches, and perform this skip on the world map. But what if I told you that there is something even more broken than that glitch? Something that is even more broken than the cat suit. This is the Tanuki suit. Using similar momentum preserving techniques to that of the cat suit, you're able to yield crazy results with the Tanuki suit, and outside of that, you're even able to combine the two by using one to gain momentum and the other to preserve it. While Super Mario Odyssey has only been out for about 5.5 years at the time of this recording, it too has been broken beyond belief. It's no secret that this game has an elevated and complex moveset, but things get even more complicated when captures enter the equation. You're able to use glide on a clip through a plethora of walls, this fish to clip out of bounds, and this ladder to achieve an infinite score in the jump rope minigame. But the first big technique to be discovered and utilized in speedruns would be the roll cancel clip, which as the name implies, you first do a roll in which you then cancel the roll, which allows for you to bypass certain areas such as this inverted pyramid wall or even this random wall in Snow Kingdom. A few months later, another trick called the moon clip would be discovered, in which you'd be able to get out of bounds if you were able to backflip and cap throw against a moon that is right next to a wall. Years later, the moon clip would be expanded upon as players figured out a way to do this triple jump moon clip, which can be seen here in Wooded Kingdom as players use a skip to get all the way to this moon without having to go all the way around. Outside of that, a bunch of miscellaneous tricks would be found. In Luncheon Kingdom, you're able to use this pan bro to bypass this moon barrier and collect it. In Cascade Kingdom, you're able to scale this wall thanks to a very small point of collision in the wall that you're barely able to land on. In Sand Kingdom, you're able to not only use this platform to clip out of bounds, but you're able to plant this seed, go into the settings of your Switch, move time forward, and spawn the seed instantly as opposed to having to wait 20 minutes. There's even this infinite height glitch that involved getting a nut wet so that you could jump, throw the nut, grab the nut midair, and do it all over again to achieve said height. I mean, for crying out loud, you're able to use Bowser himself to skip the entire 2D section. While there are plenty more glitches in not only this game, alongside all the other games, there's one glitch in Odyssey that I still find almost impossible to believe, despite it being discovered years ago, given its sheer absurdity. This is a CRC. Now, that was probably the lamest looking thing I've shown, but let me explain.
The CRC, or the Cappy Return Cancel, is a glitch in which you are able to propel Cappy to unimaginable distances, which is useful in categories such as minimum captures. Now, you may be wondering, Anto, what the hell is minimum captures? Well, I'm glad you asked, because in this speedrun category, your objective is to beat the game with as few captures as possible, which the lowest number of captures people are able to beat the game with currently is at 3. Using the CRC, you are able to get Cappy to touch certain things, such as checkpoints, which allows for you to get to that part of the kingdom without having to capture anything. Alongside minimum captures, a player by the name of Tyrone18 has absolutely dominated not only any percent, but the other main board categories, with the exception of 100% in all moons, as Heather holds that throne. And players even indulge in competitive Koopa freerunning, and even trick jumping, which involves pulling off crazy precise jumps. While Bowser's Fury is included alongside 3D World, this game has a mind of its own. There's a decent amount of out-of-bounds glitches scattered throughout the game, alongside some interesting visual glitches, but there's one thing that allows for you to chaotically traverse through the whole world of Bowser's Fury. This one thing would be vectoring. I know I've mentioned vectoring throughout the video, but the vectoring you're able to do in Bowser's Fury is simply just unfair. All it takes is a simple roll forward and a few jumps side to side, and you'll be going faster than Sonic the Hedgehog. As you can imagine, vectoring becomes even more OP upon collecting the cat suit, which I think is pretty self-explanatory. I mean, it's a cat suit. But given Fury's quirks, players have not only been able to optimize 81 in 100 shines, but a player by the name of Nintanner was able to complete an any percent run of this game in just 25 minutes. Given that Bowser's Fury has only been out for 2 years, I have no doubt that this game will be completely transformed before we know it. Now, this would usually be where the video ends, as Bowser Fury is the last 3D Mario game to be released at the time of this recording, but there's one 3D Mario game that I have not mentioned yet. One 3D Mario game that just might be the most underlooked when it comes to how broken it is. This game would be none other than Super Mario 64 on the DS. Given that this game is a remake, you would think that there wouldn't be much different about it when compared to the game that started it all. However, this thought couldn't be any farther from the truth. For starters, this game features Yoshi, Wario, and Luigi, who all have their own unique abilities, alongside 30 additional stars for you to collect. While you are able to beat Super Mario 64 with 0 stars through tricks such as SBLJ, you're able to do the same in the DS version, but in a much different and even less conventional way. In this task, or tool-assisted speedrun, you are able to clip out of bounds in the castle here and make your way over to this room that would usually require you to have 1 star. From there, you do whatever the heck this is so that you can make your way over to the Goomba boss fight and collect this key that allows for you to reach the upper portion of the castle. From there, you are able to clip out of bounds using Mario through a trick called quantum tunneling, which is discovered by Really Tall, the same person who published the task I'm explaining right now. If you want a more in-depth explanation on quantum tunneling, I'll have a link to it in the description. But basically, quantum tunneling allows you to clip out of bounds in certain locations, and this is one of them, which is convenient because it allows you to go straight to the final stage and beat the game with 0 stars. While I didn't cover every aspect of every game, I hope this gives you guys an idea of how broken every 3D Mario game truly is, but more importantly, I want everyone to know that the stories of each of these games is far from being over, as this is only the beginning. From Super Mario 64 to Bowser's Fury and everything else in between, this has been a brief introduction on how players broke every 3D Mario. Thanks for watching, and let me know what you want to see in the future.